Hello students, welcome to Byju's IS. Welcome to a session on economy this week, wherein we'll be taking some of the very important articles that have appeared in various business related newspapers, and we'll be analyzing these particular articles. For this particular time period, I've chosen the dates of 6th to 12th of July 2020, and the articles that I've chosen are from Business Line, Hindu, Business Standard, Indian Express and Live Mint. The first article is related to Atmanirbhar in agriculture or self-reliance in agriculture sector. Very recently, Government of India has taken various measures to nudge India towards the idea of a self-reliance in various areas. For example, we are promoting the idea of a self-reliance in manufacturing. We are promoting idea of self-reliance in a defense sector now. So, Government of India is taking various measures in order to promote the idea of Atmanirbharta or self-reliance. This article discusses that the same way Government of India should also promote the idea of a self-reliance in the agriculture sector. Some of the very important points given in this particular article are, one, in 1960s, we faced the food security issue. Because of various issues, there is a problem related to food security in India. As a result of this particular food security or food scarcity, India ended up importing food grains from countries such as USA. Under the concept of a PL 480 or Public Law 480. But the difference between that time period and the present situation is that today the forex reserves which are held by India are very high. In fact, they have crossed more than $500 billion recently. So despite the change in the economic situation, even today the farmers are facing a lot of issues in the agriculture sector. The incomes of the farmers are not sufficient. The number of farmers who are there in the BPL category are very high. Though Government of India has stated that they want to double the income of the farmers, practically it is not possible to achieve that in the present context. Because in the time period or in the last 4 years during which this particular objective was in play, the agriculture sector has faced many issues. For example, there have been droughts, there have been excess rainfall, the growth rate in the agriculture sector in many of the years has been very dismal. So in this particular area, how does Government of India promote the idea of a self-reliance? This particular author has focused on the idea of exports and imports. Some of the very important facts which are given with respect to exports and imports are, the agriculture exports peaked in the year 2013 and 2014. In that year, the agriculture sector exports amounted to $43.6 billion. And in the same year, the agriculture imports were $18.9 billion. So in net, India exported agriculture commodities, or there was a net agriculture exports to the tune of around $25 billion. Compare this particular numbers with what has happened in the last 6 years. The same article states that in the last 6 years, overall agriculture exports have stood at around $36 billion, and the agri-trade surplus has stood at just over $11 billion. In simple terms, from $25 billion, the agriculture trade surplus has kept on declining. This despite India being a net agriculture exporter between the time period of 2010-11 to 2019-20. So for these particular 10 years, India has been a net exporter, but the amount of the trade surplus or agriculture trade surplus has kept on declining in the last couple of years. So this article states that in order to achieve this particular idea of a self-reliance in the agriculture sector, in order to promote more and more incomes for the farmers, Government of India should focus on promoting more and more exports and reducing the imports. What has happened with respect to imports? The agriculture imports, especially in the oil segment, that is vegetable oils or consumable oils, have kept on increasing over a period of time. Out of the total agriculture imports, these particular edible oil imports form the most important part of the agri imports. Now, apart from this, the article also says that in case of exports, majority of the exports or a substantial amount of exports are basically in the form of rice and sugar. But the author says that this is not the right approach with respect to agriculture exports. Why? First and foremost, rice and sugar both get huge amount of subsidies by the government. And the amount of subsidies given to these two crops amount to around 15 to 20% of the value of production. And this is very high. and various other countries have already opposed the subsidies which are given by the government to these particular agriculture commodities. So that is one issue. Second issue is that these particular crops consume huge amount of water. These are water guzzling plants, and these particular crops require huge amount of water, and we are exporting a substantial amount of the production of these commodities to the rest of the world. It means virtually we are exporting water from India to rest of the world. So these are the two issues with respect to these particular exports. So what is the way forward? The author says that rather than focusing only on these two, focus on other commodities also, such as fruits and vegetables. This is the first point. Second, with respect to imports. As already mentioned, in terms of imports, the vegetable oils or edible oil imports are very, very substantial in value. The author says that Government of India should promote the domestic cultivation of these particular crops so that the dependence on the imports comes down and the outflow of dollars will also come down. In terms of vegetable oil imports, the author has focused on one crop, that is oil palm. As per the fact given in this particular article, the only crop, or this is the only oil crop which has got the highest amount of productivity, that is for every 1 million hectare which is used for the cultivation of this particular crop, the output will be 4 times this, that is 4 million tons oil can be produced, or vegetable oil can be produced. And as per the fact given in the article, there is a 2 million hectare land which is available which can be used for the cultivation of oil palm, which would account for 8 million tons of output of this particular vegetable oil. So these are some of the points which are discussed in this particular article. Based on this, I have given a question. Consider the following statements. India has been a net importer of agriculture commodities for the time period between 2010-11 to 1920. Wrong. It has been a net exporter. I have already discussed this particular point. Second, in the export basket, rice and sugar are among the top. This is correct, and all of this information is based on the article which we have discussed earlier. So the right option will be option B. Only second statement is true. Next article is related to trade surplus and current account surplus. For the fourth quarter of financial year 20, India registered a current account surplus. Now, what do you mean by a current account surplus? Please understand, India trades with the rest of the world. There will be capital inflows coming into India, dollars will be flowing out of India, FDI coming into India, FPI flowing out of India, goods will be coming into India, services will be flowing out of India. So India conducts a trade with the rest of the world. Rather than discussing all of this, I'll simply put it in a statement, that is, all the import and export transactions will be mentioned in a record called as a balance of payments. Is it okay? The balance of payments has got three accounts. I'll be focused on the first account, that is the current account. In case of the current account, we usually focus on the exports and imports, focus on in remittances and out remittances, focus on interest received and interest paid. So in case of the current account, whenever the receivables, that is inflow of dollars, is higher than the payments, or else I can replace this with revenue and expenditure respectively. So whenever in case of the current account, the revenue side is higher than the expenditure side, we call this as a current account surplus. And it is very few times that India has seen that there is a current account surplus as well as a trade surplus, which I'll come to that later. So for the fourth quarter, that is basically from January to April of 2020, India has registered 0.1% of GDP in the form of a current account surplus. And after this, we have seen that the trade deficit has come down, and in subsequent months, there has also been a trade surplus registered by Indian economy. Now, what do you mean by trade deficit and trade surplus? Generally, we see that in case of a trade deficit, let's say the merchandise, that is goods, the goods will be exported, goods will be imported. In case of India, the goods which are exported, the value of that is much, much lesser compared to the goods which are imported. Rather than using the term goods, they use the term merchandise. So in case of India, generally we see that merchandise imports are very, very high compared to merchandise exports. And that is a precise reason. Generally we see that India has a merchandise trade deficit. And post 1997, there have been very, very few instances where India has registered a positive current account surplus or the positive trade surplus. And since very recently, that is from the fourth quarter, there is the occurrence of a current account surplus as well as the trade surplus. This article discusses why this particular surplus, though beneficial or though it is considered to be good, not actually preferred. Now, idea is simply this. Please understand this very, very carefully. The current account surplus has occurred in case of India because the trade deficit has come down and eventually it has become a trade surplus. And apart from this, one of the reason why this particular surplus is being observed is because of higher invisible exports. For example, India imports softwares and exports the software. The value of the ITES products which are exported are much, much higher compared to these particular imports. As a result of this, in case of India's balance of payments, there's a huge invisible exports which has added to the reduction in the deficit and adding to the surplus. Now, generally, why there has been a huge amount of a trade deficit? The imports, as already mentioned, are very, very high. But one of the reasons these particular imports are very high are because of non-essential imports. What has been seen in case of India? With the impact of the COVID, the supply chain structure has been disrupted. There has been a lockdown. The economic activity has got disrupted. As a result of this, the imports have been affected. The exports also have been affected. And overall outcome has been that India has experienced or has registered a trade surplus. Though there's a trade surplus, initially I said that this is not a preferable trade surplus or a not very good trade surplus. Now, why I'm using this kind of a statement? Whenever there's a trade surplus, please understand there are certain positive outcomes. Now, what do you mean by this? Basically, when there's a trade surplus, the net outflow of a dollar will not take place. Rather, there's a net inflow of a dollar. That is considerably a good outcome of this particular trade surplus. But it's also important to understand how we have come to this particular trade surplus. In recent times, we have achieved this particular trade surplus because of, please understand this, our exports have come down, but more importantly, our imports have come down by a much larger margin compared to exports. If you see this particular table, all the information has been provided. You need not have to mug up these particular numbers. All you need to understand is this. The exports have taken a hit. The exports have come down, which means a dollar inflow has come down. If only this has happened, the trade deficit should have expanded. But in addition to this, what has happened? The value of imports which used to flow into India have taken a much bigger hit. The decline has been very, very high in terms of imports compared to the decline in case of exports. As a result of this, the imports have come down. The dollar outflow also has come down. As a result of both of these outcomes, in addition to the inflow of in remittances, there is a trade surplus experienced by India. But why this kind of a trade surplus is not preferential or not preferred? It is not preferred for a simple reason. Please understand, imports form a very, very important part and parcel of Indian economy. Why these are very important? Some of these imports are directly consumed by the households. Some of the imports are used as raw materials. Some of the imports are used as intermediary goods. Now, what is the importance of all of these particular classification? Whenever they are used as intermediary goods or raw materials, these are used to produce goods and sell the final goods in the market, which are, let's say, consumed by the domestic households. And whenever the manufactured goods are imported directly into India, these are sold as a final goods in India. And if the imports have come down, it means what? The demand or the aggregate demand for these kind of goods also has come down. And this particular decline in the demand represents a slowdown in the domestic market. That is the precise reason various experts have cautioned that don't celebrate about this particular trade surplus, because one of the prominent reasons why we are experiencing a trade surplus is because there is a slowdown in the domestic market. And whenever there's a slowdown in the domestic market and the imports are coming down, please understand, you will have to recorrect or change the course of the activity. You will have to address this particular issue. Otherwise, what will happen? This particular slowdown will keep on continuing, spiral out of the control. India may fall into recession, which is very, very likely in the present situation. So these are some of the points which are discussed in this particular article. Based on this, I've given a question here. Which of the following is or are likely to reduce the current account deficit? Please underline the term likely. First one, prohibiting non-essential imports. So if Government of India imposes certain restrictions on non-essential imports, do you think it will reduce the current account deficit? Is it likely to reduce the current account deficit? Definitely yes. A case in point is the discussion which is happening at the government level that they want to reduce the import of the non-essential imports which are coming into India from China. For example, plastic toys. These are not essential commodities, these are non-essential. So Government of India is trying to discuss or trying to bring certain measures in order to reduce these kind of a non-essential imports. And if these non-essential imports come down, will it help in reduction of the current account deficit? Definitely yes. First point is correct. Increased inward remittances. If inward remittances keep on coming into India, and if they keep on increasing, do you think it will help in reduction of the current account deficit? Definitely yes. And please make a note of this. India is the largest recipient of in remittances in the global market. Though it is the largest, very recently various reports have pointed out that the in remittances will be hit in the current year. So second point is also correct. Reduced exports. If exports come down, will it add to the current account deficit or reduce the current account deficit? It will add to the current account deficit. So third one is wrong. Increased inflow of FDI. Please understand. Although most of you will jump to a conclusion, or some of you will jump to a conclusion, this will also contribute to reduction current account deficit, but it is wrong for a simple reason. FDI is a part of a capital account, not a current account, and the question is only on current account. So fourth one is also wrong. First and second are correct, and the right option will be option D, only 1 and 2. Next question, in the fourth quarter of financial year 20, India registered a current account surplus. Which of the following is or are or has or have contributed to this particular surplus? Shrinking of imports, has it contributed to current account surplus? Definitely yes. Increased merchandise exports? No, merchandise exports have actually come down, not increased. Wrong. Surplus in invisible exports? Definitely yes. So 1 and 3 are correct. Right option will be option C. Only 1 and 3 are correct. I've given a descriptive question also. Though the trade surplus is generally considered good, the current one in India is a bittersweet moment. Suggest some measures to the government in 250 words. The next article is related to solar energy. Two very important points are discussed here. One, very recently auction was conducted for developing 2000 megawatt of solar energy capacity. And second, a point related to renewable purchase obligation. Let me start with the first one. Very recently, SECI, Solar Energy Corporation of India, conducted an auction of 2000 megawatt of solar energy capacity. That is basically it laid out 2000 megawatt of capacity and various participants participated, bid for the amount and were allocated this particular energy capacity. Now, why this is very important? With this particular auctioning, for the first time, the solar prices have dipped to their lowest to 2.36 rupees per unit. Now, why this is important? Please understand, as the solar prices keep on coming down like this, it means that the solar energy or generally electricity is available at a cheaper cost in the market. Is it okay? Why it is important? Imagine, I am a developer, you are the state government. So you will have to supply the electricity to the households. So the state government will purchase electricity from various generators of electricity, or generally called as GenCos. If the cost of production for GenCo is very, very less, if this particular GenCo has bid this particular electricity at a very, very low cost, it means the supply cost to the state government will also be very, very low. So the cost of procurement for the state will also be very, very less. In simple terms, electricity will be available at a cheaper cost in the market. And this will help the Government of India in achieve the 175 gigawatt renewable energy target it has set up. Out of this particular 175 gigawatts, the Government of India has set a target of 100 gigawatts of solar energy. And in order to attain this particular 100 gigawatts renewable energy capacity, that is specifically solar energy, whenever these particular auctions are conducted, more the participation will lead to lesser tariffs, and lesser tariffs will lead to what? The cheaper electricity availability to all or the consumers in the market. Now, this particular auctioning is important for other reasons also. This auctioning was conducted during the pandemic. Now, why this is important? During pandemic, it was seen that the demand for electricity has reduced. This happened for a simple reason. During pandemic, there was a lockdown imposed by the government. Many of these particular factories which demanded electricity were shut down. As a result of this, the overall demand for electricity also came down. However, when this particular auctioning was conducted, the participants which took part were very, very high. As a result of this, the prices or the auction prices were very, very low. Second, it also is an important point for a simple reason. Not only the domestic participants were there, even the foreign companies participated in this particular auction. What is the importance of this? Importance is that even the foreign companies have more reliability or have more faith in the recovery of Indian economy. And third, with the lower prices or the tariffs becoming lower and lower like this, the electricity will be available at a cheaper cost to all the domestic consumers. These are the three very important outcomes of this particular auctioning. And second, the central government very recently stated that it will ensure that the obligations under RPOs will be followed. And the government has stated that it is thinking of bringing penal restrictions or penal provisions if RPOs are not followed. Now, question is, what is this RPO? RPO stands for Renewable Purchase Obligation. Under this particular Renewable Purchase Obligation, imagine you are a state DISCOM, that is a state distribution company. Out of the total electricity that you consume or basically purchase and distribute to the consumer, a percentage of it has to be taken from renewable sources only. I'll repeat the statement. Under RPO, Renewable Purchase Obligation, out of the total electricity that you purchase and sell it to the consumers in the state, part of it has to be sourced from the renewable sources only. Let's say, for example, you are consuming 100 gigawatts of electricity, and if the RPO is 10%, it means that out of 100 gigawatts of electricity that you have purchased, 10 gigawatts should be from renewable sources. This has been implemented in order to ensure that there is a market available for renewable energy. That is, if I'm a renewable energy developer, I should be having a ready-made or readily available market wherein I can easily sell this particular electricity. If the people who are purchasing this particular electricity are not available, don't you think that will affect the renewable energy capacity that will be developed? And one more very important point is RPOs are basically fixed by State Electricity Regulatory Corporation. SERC is a fix up these particular RPOs, and they will ensure that the states will meet these particular RPOs. So these are some of the very, very important points given in this particular article. Based on this, I've given a question. Consider the following statements. Renewable purchase obligations are fixed by state governments. Not essentially true or not technically true. These are fixed by SERCs. Second, RPO targets can be met through RECs. RECs basically stands for Renewable Energy Certificates. Now, what do you mean by this particular renewable energy certificate? Imagine out of 100 gigawatts that I taken earlier as an example, I'm supposed to purchase 10 gigawatts of electricity from renewable energy sources. But what if I'm unable to do that? Basically, this particular 10 gigawatts, one way, just a hypothetical example, I can meet this particular target or deadline by purchasing 10 gigawatt equivalent of renewable energy certificates in the market. So this one is true. So only second statement is true. Right option will be option B. Only second is true. Next one is related to very recent policy of Government of India to allow the private sector companies to participate in the functioning of railways. Though many of the newspapers are calling this as a privatization of railways, technically speaking, this is nothing but liberalization in the railways. Because generally when we use the term privatization, we basically say that the government will withdraw completely from this particular sector. And it will allow only the private sector to operate in this particular sector. But if you read the document very, very carefully, this particular idea was basically proposed by Vivek Debrao committee. And the Vivek Debrao committee itself had stated in 2014 that way forward for Indian railways is liberalization, not privatization. Okay, so this is the basic difference. Again, I'm saying that most of the articles, most of the newspapers are saying that it is privatization. technically speaking, and even if you see, I'll show you the points here. It is not completely privatization, because even now, when we are going to allow the private sector companies to be participant or participate in this particular Indian Railways, all the functions will not be handled by the private sector. Only part of the functions will be handled by the private sector, and the core functions are even today will be handled by the Indian Railways itself. Before that, some of the important points are, by 2023, Government of India has stated that it will allow the private companies to operate or run the trains. Some of the routes will be run by the private sector companies. And the routes which have been opened up are 109 routes, and we are expecting 151 private train services being provided in these particular routes. And with this particular idea, we are expecting a total investment of more than 30,000 crore rupees in this particular Indian Railway segment. First and foremost, please understand this. Even after independence, there were certain routes, certain services which were provided only by the private sector entities. But post-independence, Government of India in the year 1951 nationalized the railways. Now, what do you mean by nationalization? In simple terms, to put in simple terms, nationalization is opposite to privatization. In case of privatization, government withdraws itself, private sector will come into play. In case of nationalization, government will take over the ownership, private sector will be pushed to the periphery. Exactly opposite. In 1951, Government of India nationalized the railways. And post that, this particular Indian Railways has been a departmental undertaking. That is basically, a ministry has been set up, and this particular ministry is taking care of the operations of railways. But over a period of time, it has been seen that there have been certain issues which are plaguing the functioning of Indian Railways. For example, out of the total transportation done in India for the freight, in the beginning, that is after independence, majority of the freight transportation was handled by the Indian Railways. Around 90% of the total freight transportation was contributed by Indian Railways. Over a period of time, the Indian Railways contribution has kept on coming down, and the road transportation has kept on increasing. Recently, it has been seen that around 50 to 60% of the freight transportation is accounted by the road transportation. Just around or above 30% comes from the railways. And that has affected the revenues which are earned by the Indian Railways. And in terms of revenues, there is another very important issue. Indian Railways subsidize the travel for the passengers, especially for the poor people. In case of the subsidization, these particular railway tariffs are heavily subsidized. As a result of this, Indian Railways revenue is also affected. The recovery rates in case of passenger segment is very, very poor. Now, in addition to this, very recently, CAG report, Comptroller Auditor General report has stated that the operating ratio for Indian Railways is more than 98.4%, and it is the highest in the last 10 years. And this was for a period of 2017 and 2018. Now, what do you mean by operating ratio? Operating ratio basically refers to the expenditure incurred in order to generate a revenue of 100 rupees. I repeat it, operating ratio basically represents the expenditure which is incurred in order to generate a revenue of 100 rupees. And the CAG report says that the Indian Railways is spending 98.4 rupees to generate a revenue of 100 rupees. So the expense ratio is very, very high, and it is the highest in the last 10 years. So in order to address some of these particular issues, Government of India has very recently announced that some of the routes, you will have the private sector participation. And these particular routes will be auctioned, private sector entities will have to participate, and once they win the bid, please understand this, the operations will be divided between the Indian Railways as well as the private sector entities which will be operating on this particular route. Now, what function will be handled by whom? As per the document, please make a note of this. The operations and infrastructure, including the safety related operations, will be handled by the Indian Railways. And apart from this, the private sector players will be handling onboard services, including ticketing, catering, and housekeeping. So, as earlier mentioned, it is not the private sector which will run all the things in case of the railways. The services will be divided between the Indian Railways as well as the private sector players. Private sector players will be handling the onboarding services such as catering, ticketing services, whereas the services related to infrastructure providing or the safety related services, all of them will be handled by Indian Railways. Now, apart from this, some of the issues have been discussed in this particular article. What are the issues? First and foremost, the pricing issue. Once the private sector will enter into this particular segment, obviously it will look at making profits. And as already mentioned, in case of India, the passenger segment, especially at a lower level, there's a huge subsidization which is provided by the government. It is expected that with quality services which will be provided by these particular private sector entities, the demand for these services is expected to increase. As such, as per the Ministry of Railways, the demand as of now for the railway services is higher than what is being supplied. And these routes which have been selected for the private sector participation, the demand has always been higher. So the idea here is that with entry of the private sector, better quality of services will be provided. And when better quality of services such as, let's say, on-time arrival and departure are provided, and on-board better quality services are provided, the demand for these kind of railways services will increase. And for availing these kind of services, the passengers will be willing to pay even premium fares also. This was also mentioned by Bibek Debroy committee. Now, here is a problem with respect to this. If on-time arrival has to be met, that is the timing have to be met, these particular railways will have to operate at a higher speeds. And in case of India, we do not have many railway routes which will operate at a very high speeds. One route which is known for operating at a very high speed in case of India, that is at 160 km per hour speed, is the route between Delhi Agra. Apart from this, majority of the routes have a very, very low average speeds. So if you want to ensure that these kind of quality services are provided, you will have to invest in these kind of infrastructure. Apart from this, another issue is the issue of infrastructure. We expect the dedicated freight corridor to be commissioned in 2021. And if there is any delay with respect to these kind of infrastructures, based on which there is a huge amount of dependence, then obviously other services or other dependent services will also get affected. So these are some of the issues which have been raised in this particular article related to the private sector participation in the railways. Now, based on this, I've given a question here. Consider the following statements. Railways was nationalized in 1951, correct? In the last decade, the operating ratio of railways has steadily declined. Completely wrong. First of all, whenever they use the term steadily in any of the statements and prelims, so please be very, very careful. So in case of the operating ratio, it has increased, especially in the last couple of years. So first statement is correct. Right option will be option A. Only one is true. So these are some of the very important articles as well as the questions related to these particular articles for this particular time period. Thank you. Have a good day.